Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. Today is the beginning of a new series of videos where I want to tackle a few Chinese antique assets. So in today's video, I will show you my approach to create this Chinese ornament. I want to eventually design Chinese style, either characters or props, but before that, I need to familiarize myself with the style. So I decided to do a few real life ones as a practice. If you watched my videos before, you know that my tutorials are more asset based instead of technique based. What I mean by that is I'm more focused on looking for solutions for a specific problem based on a specific asset. It's not so much about the functions of a software. So in these videos, I might not show you every button I pressed unless it's something super tricky, but I will mention the techniques I used. If you don't know this specific technique, I will recommend searching the keywords on YouTube. You will find how to do it, and there are so many great videos out there for that purpose. With the asset like this, the first thing I do is to create an image plane for it. For a flat, almost like a flat shape asset like this, image plane is the best thing to do because it will help you to capture the proportion and position of everything, so you have a better chance actually matching the reference. I already finished the base modeling part of this asset and I will show you what it looks like. So here it is. I will move the image plane aside so we can see a little bit clearly and compare both. So this part is super simple. Everybody started modeling should be able to model that. And this part also super duper simple. So the next thing I'm looking at on the asset is those ornamented kind of snake head looking things. And for me, this is mostly a ZBrush job. So I created a very simple shape that I will bring into ZBrush, sculpt it out, and eventually retopple and reproject the details. So those are my plan for those ones. The next element that we have to figure out how to do is those snake body looking things that's entangled together. So my solution for those guys is to draw curves according to the image plane and create that shape. After I'm happy with the curves, I will extrude faces along the curves to create the actual geometry. So I had those four faces selected and I selected the curve, not the faces, and then I use just a normal extrude. This is how I got the shape for the snake bodies. And the next step I would do is to bring everything into ZBrush. The proportion of the objects needs to be tweaked, become more accurate, matching the reference, and I find that inside of ZBrush is the fastest way to do that. So I brought all the geometry into ZBrush as a separate subtools, so it's easier to move them around without interfering with each other. Mostly I'm just using Move Brush here. I like to do this process in ZBrush just because Move Brush is so much faster than try to poke points inside of Maya. Sometimes I do go back and forth from ZBrush back into Maya and back into ZBrush a few times just to make sure the basic shape of the geometry is matching the reference. Also, I always use very low poly geometry in these steps because the higher the geometry is, the harder it is to manipulate. Now we're good with the basic shapes. I'm going to focus on the little piece that I'm going to sculpt. So like I said before, I only modeled out the basic shape. This thing is going to be mostly sculpting. After that, we're going to reproject the detail onto a new geometry that I will probably using ZRemesher to create. Once I'm happy with the sculpting of this object, I'm going to duplicate the mesh. And I'm going to use ZRemesh to create the new typology. This is the geometry we got afterwards, and now I have to subdivide this geometry and reproject the detail. I'm going a little bit faster here with my recording, but I have introduced this process many, many times in other tutorials. I will link some of it on the top. Once I finished with the projection process, I duplicated the ornaments three more times and placed it around the circle, and I'm going to do a little bit more adjustments for the snake shape to make sure it's matching the reference better. And after that, I'm going to UV everything because the next step of the geometry detail, we will need UV to do it. So looking at my main reference, there's two main patterns I have to create. One is around the circle, and one is the pattern on the body of the snake. I don't plan to sculpt those patterns by hand because it will take forever. I think the best way to do it is to do it in Substance Designer. I'm going to create a straight pattern and I'm going to displace it onto this mesh. And that is why I did a very specific UV layout for this object. For anywhere that there's a pattern, I UV the geometry completely straight. So when I do create the straight pattern inside a Substance Designer, I can just go ahead and create a completely straight pattern and project the straight pattern onto my UV inside of Mari. And after that, I will use the texture to displace the actual geometry inside the ZBrush. That's how I'm going to create the pattern. I have used this method in many assets that I created before. I will link a couple on the top. I will quickly show you what I did in Substance Designer. This type of pattern is not super complicated. That's why my designer scene is fairly small. And so this is pattern one that I created, and this is pattern two for the snake body. In general, it's pretty generic. I will show you one thing here is to use directional warp to create waves. So I have basically a straight pattern, and then I have this kind of gradient tubes that I created, and I combined them with the directional warp and I got this wave pattern. And you can actually adjust the gradient tube to get different kind of waves, so it's up to you to experiment. And I just need to move the position around and eventually create this kind of combined pattern for my circle. And for the other one, the snake body, it's mostly just tile sampler, kind of moved around, mirrored, and then create some kind of a middle area for the ridge. And that's about it. Now I'm going to project this pattern inside of Mari onto the correct position of my geometry. The only slight tricky thing here is I have to create a merge node with its own mask for every section that I need to project a pattern, because I can't just tile this. It's going to be all over the place. It's not going to be in the right position. So I have to tile it and actually just mask it to one of those bars that I need to position it at, and then create another merge node, another tileable node to do the next one. So I have to basically every area that I need a pattern to be at, I need its own separate mask, its own separate layer. Once I finish all the tiling, this is what it looks like. I wouldn't know if this is good enough or not until I start testing them, start to displace them inside of ZBrush. You can see how many merge node I actually use, because every little section has its own merge node and its own tileable node. The next step is to test them. So first I'm gonna subdivide my geometry, make sure there's enough resolution for me to displace my maps. And then I'm going to texture map, turn it on, and I'm going to displace the map and go to where I exported my displacement from Mari. And I'm going to create a new layer, so everything's gonna be on separate layer, and turn up the opacity. Turn up the intensity, and that's what it looks like. It's looking a little bit crazy. I feel like I definitely need to adjust them quite a bit. I feel like mostly it's because the white area of the displacement is a little too white. So when you displace it, it looks crazy. I'm going to adjust it inside of Mari a little bit and re-displace, and I'm going to show you what it looks like. After adjusting the map a few times and re-displayed it quite a few times actually, I finally is happy with what it looks like currently. The next thing I would do is to add some surface detail to it. When you look at the reference, the surface is quite broken up. The mesh currently is looking way too smooth and perfect. Because the surface detail for me from the reference looks pretty fractal and like general noise, there's nothing too specific that stands out. I'm going to just use the surface tab inside of ZBrush to lay down some very simple generic surface breakup. There is a bunch of presets inside of Lightbox, and you can adjust the intensity, the scale, and frequency of the detail. There are quite a few different presets inside of Lightbox, so sometimes I like to apply each onto a different layer and kind of mix them and see what kind of results I can get. We are at the last step before we can finally start the texturing process. After the fine surface kind of noise like breakup, is the geometry is still looking a little too generic. So the last thing is just some final touches that I actually have to sculpt by hand. I'm gonna break up the shape a little bit so it's not so straight and smooth. I'm using damp standard brush to create a few more broken area around the geometry. And just in general, try to match the irregularities with the reference. At this stage, I'm also trying to create asymmetry. All those ornamented snake head shape things was exactly the same when I duplicated it. So this is the point where I'm starting to add maybe a few more damages that's not on every one of them. In general, I'm just adding final touches to make sure the geometry is matching the reference as much as possible. After all that work, we're finally ready to bring it into Substance Painter and start the texturing process. I chose to use Painter for this asset because there is no super strong painting elements to it. It's mostly very procedural, and I have so many surface detail that I can utilize with the smart masks. I have in total 5 UDIN for this asset, and that's totally doable for my computer. I do have to wait around here and there, but in total it's not too bad. So the texturing process of this asset is actually the shorter and simpler part of the creation of the asset. It's kind of funny that now my videos are not just like texturing process video now, it's more of an asset process video. Which I think it's helpful too, because for anyone that's making a portfolio and try to apply for a job, you do have to create your own asset even if you just want to apply for a texture artist position. So for the general plan of texturing this asset, my original reference is a little too blurry. I couldn't see very clearly what's going on in terms of material. So I'm using some other Chinese like bronze antique reference as an inspiration. My general plan was to have the base material as some sort of a bronze material and have some kind of like shinier metal on top. When I'm looking at the reference, there's a few things I'm constantly thinking about is the cavity and edges. Because I do have to kind of like create the look of this thing, I have to think about it from like a more artistic point of view. I do have this bronze texture as a base, but what kind of cavity texture I'm going to have. In general, you always get this more matte kind of like a dirt texture inside a cavity like this, such as this reference we're looking at. In this reference, the cavity itself is actually brighter color than the base material. So the first thing I experimented was try to add some brighter kind of matte material inside the cavities, and then maybe add some kind of very shiny edges on top and see what that looks like. In general, I thought this looks really goofy. It looks good on the picture, but on my thing it just looks quite goofy with this kind of like light green cavity dust thing. So I tried to experiment it to make it darker as well, see if that looks better. After that, I started to add some edges as well. For the edges, is the color itself is going to be a little bit brighter than the base material, and the material itself is going to be a shinier material. I also started experimenting with maybe putting some patina material on top since it's metal to try to break up the color a little bit with this very red kind of object with a little bit touch of green. Maybe it will add more interest. In general, I just feel like it does not look as good as in the reference photo. I kind of have to do my own thing a little bit. It's quite hard to describe this kind of texturing. I'm just adding different elements for the object, like inside the cavity, on the edges, different colors, experiment with different colors. It's almost like mixing paint, so it's hard to describe the process. I'm just making sure that there is some sort of complementary color, there's a good contrast, and there is a good contrast between a matte area and shiny area. I'm just constantly adjusting those things and mixing those things until I see something that looks good. I'm just gonna jump straight into what I end up doing in the end to get the final look. Technically, this thing is really nothing special. So the first layer I have is just a base iron layer, and I make sure that it's not too shiny. So later on, I can have some shinier material for contrast. So I added some kind of bluish darker tone inside of the cavity and a little bit on the surface as well. And the next thing I did is to kind of break up the shape of the object a little bit to have some kind of golden paint. So the whole object doesn't just look like one thing and kind of boring, have some kind of different element on top. And the paint is sort of getting scratched off as well to reveal some of the other colors underneath it. And the last thing I did was the edges. This is probably the most shiny material on the whole thing. And I give it a little bit of a golden tone as well, but it's more desaturated than the kind of paint on top. And it's something that can tie everything sort of together, so the material on top doesn't look so separated from everything else. That is the whole process video of how I created this object. It's more of a general strategy video than a step-by-step tutorial. I hope you guys enjoy that. If you enjoy this type of video, like the video and subscribe to my channel. That is everything I have for you today. I will see you in the next one.